us, Father. You are the breath of our lives, Father. You are everything to us. And Father, today as we go into your word, Father, we truly understand that who you truly are, Lord. That we know that heaven is what we seek out in our hearts, Lord.
Yeah.
And in that heaven, Lord, we know it's a place, Father. We know it's paradise, Father. But most importantly, it's a person. And that person is you. We just praise you and thank you that today we can have that glimpse of you. And Father, I just pray as we go through your word today that both spirit and truth will prevail here, Lord. And that your presence would be among us, Lord. We can take this life that we have here, take it out to this world, Father. For lost souls, especially, Lord. Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And you may be seated. Well, we just finished a series on James. A lot of people think James is all about wisdom, but really, I feel like it's more about hope. And we're going to get into a series on 1 Peter. And if you have your Bibles, if not, you have your phones, because no one has goes without a phone anymore. It's amazing. We can walk around all day long without a Bible, but we never go anywhere without a phone. The other day, in fact, I think it was yesterday, I came here, started setting up some things for the wedding that took place, and I forgot my phone. All right? And it's amazing how many phone calls you get when you don't have your phone. Right? Anyway, I finally found my phone, and it was blowing up. Right? From phone call after phone call. It's just amazing how this just happens. You know what? For the moment there, it kind of gave you a little freedom, didn't it? I had one of those days where you just unplug. And anyway, when I get into I turned 1 John. Is that a that might be an omen there. No, let's find 1 Peter, you guys. There it is. Let's go. Boy, that has nothing to do with my sermon today. All right. 1 John. Anyway, let's take a look at 1 Peter. Start right at verse 1, right? And it says right here, to God's elect, I'm sorry, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to God's elect, God's elect, strangers in the world, scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God, the Father, through his sanctifying work of the Spirit, in obedience to Jesus Christ by the sprinkling, and sprinkling by his blood. Grace and peace be yours in abundance. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance. Guys, focus on that word right there for a moment. Inheritance that can never perish, never spoil, never fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice. Though now, for a little while, you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials, these have come so that your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine, and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him, and even though you do not see him now, you believe in him, and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Concerning the salvation, the prophets who spoke of the grace that was to come to you searched intensely and with the greatest care, trying to find out the time and circumstances to which the Spirit of Christ in them was pointing, when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you. When they spoke of the things that have now been told you by those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, even angels long to look into these things. Now, I look at this passage and I'm thinking here is that, you know what? Heaven. Get this in your minds, guys. Heaven is a real place. Most people believe that. In fact, I've heard 81% or something like that. People in America believe there's a place called heaven. 69% believe there's a place called hell. And most people ask, you know, what's going to happen to me? You know, what's going to happen to me after I die? I've asked that question. What's going to happen to me after I die? I remember asking that question a long time ago, even before a Christian. What's going to happen to me after I die? You know, the big question is there really a God? You know, when you get people on their deathbed, they seem to ask those questions. What's going to happen to me when I die? You know? Is there really God? Is he going to really save me from all this? Will I actually go to heaven? Well, Peter tells us, and I love this verse, that God has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We know that Jesus rising from the dead gives us new hope and into an inheritance, in verse 4, an inheritance that can never perish. It can never be taken away. It can never be spoiled, or it can never fade. And this inheritance is kept in heaven for you. It means that we have an expectation of one day being in heaven. Yeah, I don't know if you guys can envision that. Like right now, you're thinking, you know what? In a few, you know, a little bit here, I'm going to be able to go out for breakfast. I'm going to go to lunch somewhere. You can picture yourself going to go be there, right? And I remember as a kid, I would think about my parents would say, you know what? We're going to take you to Disneyland. By the way, never tell a kid you're going to take them to Disneyland. Especially the day before, because they will not sleep all night long. Right? So my parents did that, did not sleep all night long. But I can envision myself being at Disneyland. You know, parking in the parking lot, riding a little tram up to the front there, walking through the front gates, right? Getting your tickets. You go in there, I can envision that. And right now you're thinking, Disneyland just opened last Friday. I want to go back. Right? You can envision going there, being there. We need to have that vision for heaven. That one day we're going to be there. So I want to talk to you about heaven because deep down inside, I think you already know it's real. You know, we're sort of pre-wired like that. It's almost like a homing pigeon. You ever seen homing pigeons? You take them in the middle of nowhere, drop them off, and you don't have to fly back, right? They'll get back. You guys ever seen the movie, Disney movie called Aristocats? Okay, Aristocats. You know, they're dropped off, and, you know, the bad butler, because we always know the butler does it, right? Butler takes the cats, you know, the mother cat, the three little kittens, right? He can't stand them, because he can't stand cats, right? He takes the cats out in the middle of a forest somewhere, of course, and he has to deal with a couple of dogs out there. Thank God for those dogs. Anyway, but these cats get dropped off in the middle of nowhere. But what do they long for? They want to go where? Come on, guys, give me the answer. You want to go where? Back home. Isn't it amazing they want to go back home to where? They want to go back home to a mansion, right? That they lived with a madam. You know, that was their god, I guess, they made at that time. They wanted to get back. They knew that the madam loved them, right? They wanted to get back there. Okay? This is a movie from the 1970s, right? We already had this concept way back then. Okay? We want to get back to where? We want to get home. Our home is not here. We want to go where? We want to go where, guys? We want to go to heaven. Right? And I know we're just like, we know that, you know, heaven is where we want to be because God has set eternity in the heart of each person. Augustine, he said this, you formed us for yourself in our hearts, and our hearts are restless until they find the rest in you. That's why there's restlessness in your life. That's why those things that don't satisfy you here in the way you hope they would is because we don't belong here. We're not satisfied here. We're never going to be truly happy here because you know why? Our home is not here. We're not home. Every once in a while, maybe I'm going on a trip, go to our kids, sometimes we go to places, most of the time we go to the kids now, right? And, you know, there comes a point where we want to be back home. We want to be back home. We want to be back in our own bed, right? We want to eat our own food, right? We want to have, isn't it amazing there's freedom in that? Right? You want to be home. C.S. Lewis said this, There have been times when I think I do not desire heaven. But even more often, I find myself wondering in my heart of hearts if I've ever desired anything else. Then he goes on to say, it's the secret signature of each soul, the incommunicable and unappeasable want. We want it. I closed off that bit last night. That's why it's humming. You can turn off. I thought it was a net. Okay, but I want to keep you guys on track here, okay? We unplugged everything yesterday. But think, you know what? This is not heaven, you guys. It's just a glimpse of it. So it's amazing if you're sitting here in a sanctuary today or you're out there on Facebook or YouTube and you're thinking about heaven, or at least you should be, right? And we have this unappeasable want, and sometimes it's difficult to express. Like, people go, why in the world do you want to go to heaven for? Well, I want to get into that. I'm sure you heard the story, every pastor in America has ever said it, about the little boy who was flying a kite, and the kite was up so high in the air. And Mindy and I used to fly kites and stuff. I have a beautiful one right now, right? We spent on flying kites, so that's a quick story. Took Emilio out, our grandma, me, right? We took her out this beautiful open field. I mean, beautiful, on a river. Okay, you would think out in the middle of this beautiful open field on a river, you would have some wind, right? We went out there twice, didn't we? Went out there twice, no wind. I mean, no wind. We couldn't get that kite up because whatever we could do. So, and the thing is, a little baby girl, you have to she's really disappointed. No, because the kite's not flying, and she doesn't understand why it doesn't fly. So what do I do? Of course, I get Mindy to take a run with the kite so it wasn't here. No, that didn't work.
I sat down and watched TV.
You watched. So I get the kite up and I start running with it. And it's flying, right? And she's squealing, she's buzzing, stuff like that. And I bring the string over to her, and then I get up high enough and hand it off to her. You know what? She holds onto it, and what's the kite do? Why doesn't it fly? Well, I'm sure you've heard the story about the boy was flying his kite, and it's so far up in the clouds you couldn't see it anymore. Right? Someone comes by and says, hey, is your kite still on the string? He goes, oh yes it is, it's there, but you can't see it. And the little boy says, no, but I can feel its tug. And I think deep down you can feel the tug of heaven. You know there's more to life than what you're experiencing now. Because you know that Jesus said, don't let your heart be troubled. Neither let them be afraid. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there is many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And if I go, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. And the way you know. And then Thomas, it's always Thomas, isn't it? Why? Because it's an illustration of us. It says Jesus, we don't know the way. And Jesus, of course, what's he saying? I am the way. I'm the way. I'm the truth and I'm the life. And no one comes unto the Father, which means goes to heaven, but by me. Because heaven is a real place. And that I know that when I die, I'm going to go to heaven. And some people ask, well, how do you know? And this is where C.S. Lewis is incommunicable. I know that I know because I am a child of God. And the Bible says that his spirit speaks to my spirit. It witnesses to my spirit that I am a child of God. Right? I am a child of God. That is how I know. His spirit tells my spirit I'm going to go to heaven. I have that assurance. In fact, we sing a song called Blessed Assurance. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory and honor. You guys know it, right? So I'm going to ask you, how many of you out there know that you're going to go to heaven? It's not a rhetorical question. I need to see hands go up. Because if not going up, I need to change this into a salvation message. You know what? If you have hope of heaven in your heart, you know in your heart of hearts, you know in your spirit, it's hope, the hope of heaven. It's kind of similar to faith, right? Which we talked about last week. You know, my hope is built on nothing less than new. In Jesus Christ and his righteousness. Now there seems to be this generation coming up. A lot of hopelessness out there, isn't there? If you bear to watch TV at all, a lot of hopelessness out there. We have this hopeless generation. A lot of people, a lot of kids out there, a lot of young people, they're either totally like gone away from God, right? Or they're violent, or seeking out something. They're argumentative. It doesn't seem to matter who's in office. They're still contrary to whatever else is going on. It's a hopeless generation, seems out there right now. I gotta ask some people out there, especially on Facebook and YouTube, are you hopeless today? I'm telling you this, if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, you can have hope. Because I'm telling you right now, don't put your hope in technology. Big tech's trying to change our lives, isn't it? We even have some big tech companies make for people work on Sundays. That's another story. Right? Don't put your hope in material things. How many of you guys check your Amazon accounts today? Don't answer that question. That was for Madonna, material girl. She said it 40 years ago. Right? What's it brought her? She can't get her teeth fixed. I mean, come on. Don't put your hope in politicians. Anybody put their hope in politicians? We put so much hope in one of our politicians here in California. Right? 2 years later, what we're trying to do? Trying to kick them out of office. What happened there? Is that trying to make up for our mistakes? How many people have put their hope in religion? We know people put their hope in religion. You know? They'll go through emotions. They'll know all the catechisms. They'll know all the chants. They'll know all the scriptures. They'll have this proof text and things like this, and they'll quote those kind of things. Right? Their hope is in a religion. Their God is the religion. Instead of pointing to Jesus Christ. So I'm telling you this, don't even put your hope in religion. Because here it is. Hope has a name. You know what his name is? His name is Jesus Christ. And he's here today with us. He's right here with us today. Because when two or more are gathered together, he promises to be here. And Jesus is ready to change the course of your life, to take you from the mire that you're in, the direction that you're going in, which is hell, and change the course of your life to heaven. Now, as a Christian, you know, I've always believed in heaven. But before I was a Christian, I kind of felt like if I died, I would just cease to exist. You know, I was trained up in the religion of evolution. Right? And here's the funny thing is, in the religion of evolution, you know, they show, you know, like an ape-looking creature, monkey creature. You know, you've seen these pictures on Life magazine, it's always famous. And it goes all the way up to, various stages of man. And man is at the final end of it. But they never show what happens to man at the end. Right? What happens at the end of that line?
Dies.
He dies. And so what happens after you die? You cease to exist. Right? And that's what I used to think. Now, about 12 years ago, I started thinking more and more about heaven. Because having a near-death experience makes you really think about your mortality. Now, as a Christian, I think about heaven a lot. Also, as I'm moving into retirement, my day job, you know, I'm in this stage of my life where, you know what, I want to do a lot of living, right? Because having a recent death of a friend, you know, we're facing eternity. Well, anyway, what is heaven like? You know, some people think, you know, what's heaven like? What's going to happen when we get there? You know, and what are we going to do every day when we're in heaven? And, you know, we have this warped sense of what, this warped concept of heaven. You know, we got movies that have, like, things about heaven, right? Then we have songs that are about heaven. And a great many of them, they just really warp what heaven's really like. You know, sometimes you get that picture, you know, we're just going to sit on fluffy white clouds, right? Playing a harp. right? We float around arcs. We're going to have halos above our heads. It's going to be little fat cherubims flying around with our babies. Little wings on them. Right? You're going to take long naps. Actually, a lot of naps sounds good, doesn't it? You know? Then it's going to be a big, big house. Lots and lots of room. Right? A big, big table with lots and lots of food. And a big, big yard so we can go play football. All right, guys, you're getting it. You guys know what heaven's like. Who did that song anyway? I don't remember who. But anyway. Well, that's not biblical heaven. That's not the real heaven. Heaven is a real place. The real heaven is a place. Jesus said, I've gone to prepare a place for you. The Bible says that heaven is like a paradise. Right? Do you remember what Jesus said when he hung on the cross? He's on the cross, right? He's got the thieves up there. Right? These guys, they're up there because they probably did something really bad, probably worse than even thieving, right? Then one man, he realizes he's in big trouble up there, right? He starts mocking Jesus. He says, hey, Jesus, you know, you saved others, and how come you can't save yourself? If you're really the Son of God, come down from the cross. And Jesus says, forgive them, Father, because they don't know what they're doing. And right there, one of those men believed. Right there, just like that, one of the men believed. And that's how it can happen. You know, in an instant, that one man, he believed. Now, you can come in here, you can be watching on YouTube or Facebook, and you know, I don't believe any of that. You know, I don't believe about this heaven stuff. You know, and then all of a sudden something happens. Someone says something, you know, I might say something happens here, you know, and then all of a sudden the light goes on. I was going to click my fingers and light them on, but, you know, light goes on, right? And then you realize, oh my gosh, this is all true. You know, and I experienced that. It was in 1980. I experienced that. There was someone who told me some stories about somebody named Jesus, and all of a sudden the lights came on, and boom, I got saved. It happened in an instant. And that man on the cross up there with Jesus, he turns to Jesus and says, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said, truly, truly, I say unto you today, you will be with me in paradise. So what is heaven? It's paradise. You know, the Apostle Paul, one occasion, remember him? He got stoned. I mean, you know, hit with rocks, not the other kind of stone, right? And, you know, he was left for dead. And at that moment, most Bible scholars believe that he died and he went to heaven. Remember he said he went to the third heaven? And he said he died and he came back again. At least he had a near-death experience. You know, and in that moment, you know, Paul, he describes it later. He says, I don't know how this happened exactly. But, you know, I was seized by Christ. I was swept up into ecstasy of heaven. And I don't know if I was in my body or out of it. Only God knows. But I tell you this much, I was in paradise. And I heard an unspeakable spoken, and I was forbidden to tell what I heard. So heaven is a place, it's paradise. But the Bible says that heaven is a city. I always thought that was kind of interesting. Heaven's a city. You guys know when we've been back, we studied the book of Revelation, we studied how big heaven was, and you know, it was, you know, deep and wide. That's why we sing the song Deep and Wide. Okay? And we found out heaven's a city. Now, I've been to some beautiful places. There's some places I've been alive. I think we were in Hawaii, right? And there was like this waterfall type thing and this and water, like in a pond cooling up there, right? And I was with this woman, and all of a sudden she jumped in her clothes, jumped in the water, and swims out to that waterfall. Now I'm thinking, man, she is crazy. Why am I hanging out with her? Right? Well, what did I have to do? I had to go follow her, right? Would you do that today? Yeah, you would. Would it kill your back? Yeah, it would. Would you suffer for it later? But what you did, you went for heaven. You went for that beauty. I'm talking to Mindy, right? It was Mindy, by the way. No mistake about that. There's some other woman out there, okay? It was her, right? We were driving a red Jeep. Remember that red Jeep? Okay. And anyway, we go out there, she swims out there, and guess what I had to do? I had to go swim up after her. Right? because I want to be where she was at. Because I want to be where God's at. I want to be where God's at. I want to be in heaven. So anyway, but now cities. Cities can be remarkable. You know? I enjoy cities. Actually, I enjoy little small downtowns. We're driving through somewhere. I said, oh, stop and run through here. Let's see what's downtown. Right? We did that on the we were driving up to Megan and Mark's. Anyways, and I took the wrong road somehow and got off the freeway in Salt Lake. Okay? Now you're thinking Salt Lake. Salt Lake, Utah. You would have, you know, that should be an oasis up there, right? Or a beautiful city. We found the worst parts of the city. And we were told later that, man, you should not have driven through there. It's dangerous. And I'm thinking, wow, places are dangerous even in Salt Lake, Utah. Right? So, anyway. So I like some cities. I love seeing skyscrapers and things like that. But I used to live in Long Beach. And I lived right off of Long Beach Boulevard. And one of the things my dad would do is that he would take us downtown and we'd walk around. Right? And there was a song back then called Downtown. I don't remember words, right? And so my dad, he would take us downtown, we'd walk around there. It was just like something to do. Right? They recreated something like that. It's called Victoria Gardens. Okay? But anyway, we go downtown, we'd walk around, and we always go to a restaurant somewhere, a downtown restaurant. This is back in the days when there was downtown restaurants. And we go downtown, we eat at the restaurant, we always get dessert, something like that. And my dad, this is always funny about him, he would always ask for a coffee to go. He would take and get a coffee to go. He would be, you know, whatever we ate, things like that, he'd always ask, hey, can I get a coffee to go? Right? This is before Starbucks. You know, he always got a coffee to go. And so that's the best memory I have of city life. So heaven is a city. The Bible tells us this, that it's a city whose builder and maker is God. So think about cities. Think about cities you've read about, maybe cities you've been to. Well, heaven is a city as well. It's paradise and it's a city. Now, here's the inside information for those people out there who are worried about being bored in heaven. You know what? In heaven, you'll never be bored. Now, you might get bored in church. You might nod off. You might be checking out your iPhone right now. Right? I know you guys. Okay? God's going to get you to that way. Right? But when you get to heaven, you know what? There's going to be things to do. You know, you can get together with loved ones. They've gone on before. Right? You can have meals together. You can reminisce together. You can do things together. You know, you get up there, you know, you probably go to concerts. You can probably go get your nails done. Right? Isn't that one of the most enjoyable things right now, to get your nails done? You know, you go get your nails done in heaven. Can you imagine going to heaven and getting your nails done?
And it's free, I'm talking.
You know? Yeah. But of course, you know, you can play golf. You can take bike, you know, take hikes. We'll probably even find our stolen bikes up there. Can you imagine that? You go bike riding up there. You probably play guitar without making mistakes. You know, you name it. You're going to have things to do in heaven. It's not going to be boring. You know? And here's the amazing thing about this. We're going to find things to do in heaven that you have never thought of before. That no one else has ever done. You're going to have the creativity to do things in heaven that you've never thought. You're not going to have any limitations. Right? It's not like in golf, you have what's called a handicap. But if there's no handicap. There's no limit to what you can really do. There's going to be things that you can do that's going to just blow your mind. And then you're going to see things that you've never seen before. Maybe animals that you've never seen before. Or mountains or sceneries that would just blow you away. That nothing on human earth could ever create. And then the thing about this is heaven is a wonderful place. It's filled with glory and grace. You know, it's your happy place. It's a joyful place. It's a place that, for this, think about this, heaven is a prepared place for prepared people. Then I think it's always fun when people ask this question. You know, are we going to recognize one another in heaven? Well, I hope I look better, personally. So So when you recognize that you have been heaven, I hope I look better to you than I do now, okay? I heard one pastor said this. He goes, do you think you're stupid in heaven? You're not going to be stupid in heaven. Of course you're going to recognize one another, right? Also, you might see me coming up and you'll run the other way, okay? They have a gold streak for that too, right? But you'll be reunited with your loved ones. It's going to be amazing. Now, let's go back to those three questions. What's going to happen to me after I die? Well, your body's going to go into the ground. Or at least on a mantle. Right? And your soul is going to enter the afterlife. And your soul will go on immediately into the presence of God, if you're a believer. And ultimately, think about this, God will give you a new body. Amen. Now that sounds like a great deal to me. I need a new body. I got pains and aches, and yesterday, Caroline up came and said, your elbow's bleeding. You know, didn't know, we got some blood all over the place, huh? By the way, we sanitized after doing that, okay, so, okay. And you know what? Think about this here. I need a new body because, you know, God, you think about this. God's original intention was that as men and women, we would never die. You know, we were given bodies that are going to last forever. You know, in the Garden of Eden, there was no death, no pain, no tears. For those out there on Facebook, there was no police officers, all right? Okay? But mankind rebelled against God because he had a will of his own. And that rebellion is called sin. And because of that sin, now we have death. You know, if Adam and Eve had not sinned, we would have never died. If Adam and Eve had not sinned, we would never have gotten sick. If Adam and Eve had not sinned, we would not age. If Adam and Eve had not sinned, and you know, the list can go on and on and on. You know what they did? They did. They broke the rules. And sin, like a disease, it entered the human race. And you know what? We're all born with it. And we're not sinners because we sin. I want to get this straight, especially those people on Facebook and YouTube, because it's amazing I see how many people actually see these. You know what? We don't sin because we're not sinners because we sin. We sin because we are sinners. It comes naturally. The Bible says that we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But listen to this. If you're a Christian, death is not the end. The Bible says the world with all its desires is passing, but he that does the will of God will live forever. Because Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I'm the life. And he that believes in me, though he were even dead, yet shall he live. Because whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. So, I got this question. Do you believe this? And I'm asking you this today, do you believe this? Because Jesus died on the cross. He took the sting of death. And that's why the Bible says, O grave, where's your victory? O grave, where's your sting? Death died when Christ arose. You live forever as a Christian. That's the hope the Bible gives us. O victory in Jesus. What? My Savior for when? Forever. So that brings me to the second question. Is there really a God? God's not dead, he's surely alive. You know, living like a lion on the inside, right? I probably messed up those words. Thank God a newsboy straightened it out for us. But some of you might say, you know, I don't believe in God. I was like that too. You know, I don't believe in God. But even right now, if you're listening to us or watching us today, you are aware of the presence of God. There's something different here. There's something, you know what, and you don't know what it is. I want to tell you what it is. It's the Lord Jesus. Jesus said, he said this here, when two or more gather together in my name, I am there in the midst of them. And Jesus says, seek the Lord while he is found. So if you're out there listening today, if you're here listening today, seek him. You call upon him while he's near. He is near to you today as you hear these words. He said, Jesus says, let the wicked man forsake his thoughts and turn to God, who will pardon you. And God is here today. God is ready to change you today. But you need to reach out to him and say, Lord, I want to know you. Yes, God is real, but don't wait until you die to figure that one out. Because then it's going to be too late. Because every man and woman will stand before God on what's called the Great White Throne Judgment. And if your name is not found in the Book of Life, you know what you're going to be doing? What's going to happen to you? You're going to be cast into the lake of fire. And I know some people hate to hear this, but it's real. You know, I don't care if 69% of Americans out there believe in hell, right? Or even more believe in heaven. But hell is as real as heaven is. Heaven is as eternal as heaven is. And the last thing God wants any person to do is to go to hell. But I can tell you this here, there's a lot of people in our lives that are going to hell. And it's your responsibility to tell them the good news of Jesus Christ. Because that's why Jesus came to this earth. He came on a rescue mission. And he came and he died in our place to reconcile us to God. He came to pay a debt that you could not pay. God is real. Because, yes, heaven is a real place. You know, it is paradise. It's a place, but you know what? It's also a person. And so here's the thing is when you ask the question, will I go to heaven? Here's the amazing thing. It's entirely up to you. If you want to go to heaven, you have to be forgiven of your sin. You have to be reconciled to God. And here's the weird thing, too. You know, people think that hell is for bad people. And heaven is for what? For good people. It's not how it works. Because what's our good definition of good? We've already known that, you know, all sin comes short of the glory of God. Think about this. It's not that hell is for bad people, that heaven is for good people. I know this is going to shock some, but you know there's going to be some good people in hell. There's going to be some bad people in heaven. And I've known people out there, you know, say, you know, I'm a good person. I'm a moral person. Yeah, but listen to this. As good as you are, you're still not good enough to get to heaven because everyone sins and falls short of the glory of God. Everyone breaks his commandments. So there will be some good people, put that in quotes, there's going to be some good people in hell because they thought they were good enough to get there on their own. You can't get there on your own. You need someone to carry you over. There's only one way to get to heaven, and that's through God's Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for you. Now, there's going to be some bad people in heaven. Now, by bad, you know what I mean? I mean sinners. And I know right now, some of you guys are out here thinking, you know what? I'm a good person, right? And some of you guys aren't even thinking, you know what? I want to give my life to Jesus. But I'm not even one step further. Are you truly living for the Lord? You know, I got to ask myself that question every day. Sometimes I need to ask myself that about minute by minute. And sometimes I get to that point where, you know what? I screwed up here. What I need to do? I need to become Jesus again. Right? We all have broken his commandments. We need forgiveness. Because the Bible says this. You know, if you confess your sins, he is faithful and just to forgive your sins. And cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Now you're thinking, you know, what do I mean by confess? I know some of you guys, when we talked about this, it was last week or a couple weeks ago, you know, confess your sins. Well, it doesn't mean you have to do it right now, right to one another. Confess your sins to God. Let him do the cleansing. Then you want forgiveness. And forgiveness means, you know what? Forgiveness means that God is going to remove all sin from you. God doesn't just forgive your sins, he also forgets your sins. In fact, he separates them as far as the east is from the west. You need to savor that every single day on your trip to heaven. To know that's where you're at with God right now. You need to understand that Jesus died on the cross for you. You need to have that in your mind all the time. Because you know what? What is God like? Well, he's Jesus. And Jesus says, you have seen me, you've seen the Father. Jesus was God with a face on. Jesus was God with skin on. Jesus walked this earth. He walked in our shoes. He breathed our air. You know, he lived our lives. He died our death, and he rose again. So heaven is a person. His name is Jesus. You know, I think about this. We need to keep that in our minds, that we have a heavenly mindset at all times. You ever lay out great plans? and God wants to change the direction of your life? You know? Because he wants you there with him. Because Jesus said, greater love has no man than this, that he laid down his life for his friends. Jesus laid down his life. He died for you in your place. And what are you supposed to do about that? You're supposed to repent. And repent means to what? To turn away from your sin and turn toward God. And you know what? Sometimes that even involves us people who are Christians. Sometimes we're caught up in our sin and we need to repent. We need to turn to God. Because we need to know that we have an inheritance that is being held for us in heaven. Right now. If you have never believed, or you've never asked Jesus to forgive your sins and give you everlasting life, then I want to give you the hope of heaven today. For today is the day of salvation. I know that in your heart, the Holy Spirit is reaching upon you right now, and you know there's something out there, there's something more. That something is Jesus. The Holy Spirit is calling upon your heart because Jesus wants you to be with him one day in heaven. It's time to put God first in your life, and you must be born again to do so. And you might be out there watching on Facebook or YouTube, or even here sometimes, you know? And you're trusting worldly wisdom. Have you ever said, you know, I think this, you know what? That's where Dr. Phil says, well, how's that working out for you? Stop thinking like this world thinks. Stop thinking worldly. Start thinking how God wants you to think about him. To place our minds on heaven so that we are heavenly focused. I know people out there said people are so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good. That's a lie to the devil. The people who are heavenly minded are the most earthly good, because the thing is, they're going to bring heaven to earth so that you can understand who God is, so that you can go to heaven. What you need to do is you need to call upon the name of Jesus, because Jesus said this. The Bible says this. Whoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. So I wonder if this is not that day for you. Because I believe that God is speaking right now to your hearts. And you realize you need Jesus. Would you like to have your sins forgiven? Would you like to have a second chance in life? Some of us need a third, fourth, fifth chance. Would you like to know that when you die, you're going to go to heaven? And understand this, it can happen in a moment. It can all happen because Jesus Christ went to the cross. He died for your sin. And then he rose again 3 days later. He'll come into your life right now and be your Savior and be your Lord and be the best friend you ever have. If you want that, then pray with me. Say, Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner, but I believe you died on the cross for my sin. I'm sorry for that sin, and I turn from it now. And I ask you to come into my life and be my Savior and be my Lord and be my God and be my friend. I choose to follow you from this day forward. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now, if you said that prayer, then that promise that Jesus will come in and your life will be renewed, be like brand new. You are a new creation, a new creature, the Bible says. And if you did that today, I want to say, welcome to the family of God. But Father, we praise you and thank you, Lord, that people have given their hearts to Jesus today, Lord. Lord, there's even people out there who believe in you, but they know their life is in a mess. They have no true direction, Father. I pray that even those out there today will turn to you, Father, because today is the day of salvation again. And Father, we just sometimes we just need to come to you over again. And Lord, we know that heaven is a paradise. It's a place that you built. You prepared it for us, and I want us to be a prepared people. But most importantly, Lord, we know it is a person. It's the person of Jesus Christ. We praise you and thank you today. In Jesus' name, amen.
I can only imagine what it will be like. Oh,
each one of us have fallen short. I know I have. Every day, I just fail by my lack of patience or my unkind words or just the ugliness, Lord, that comes out of me. God, just forgive us. Give us clean hearts that we might enter into communion with you, Lord. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 11:23, "For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the very night that he was betrayed, he took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, 'This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's partake together.
Pray for the ones that are here.